All right, the ball is back. This is Jedbanger's Ball. I'm your host, Jed Mayhew. Today we have Tom Neely and Keenan Keller. I was excited to have these guys on the show because they're super weird, fucked up comic book artists. And we basically came together to do a record for their book that they're working on right now called The Humans. They asked me to do a song for the 7-inch that accompanied the first issue. And when I asked them what it was about, they said it was basically like a 70s, late 60s biker gang made up of fucking monkeys. So that's what the song's about. So maybe at the end of the interview here, we'll play a little bit of that so you can hear what that is. But without further ado, here's Tom Neely and Keenan Keller on Jedbanger's Ball. Basically, I mean, I wanted to just start off. We have two people here today, so normally we'll have like one guest on, but we have two today. So I wanted to find out kind of like what your guys' relationship was to each other and how you started working together. So basically, I just wanted to know like how you guys met and how long you've known each other and that whole story.
Well, we met at like one of the most worst little zine fest we've ever been at before. I don't want to mention it by name because the people that put it together had their hearts in the right place, but it was kind of a worthless afternoon of trying to sell zines in the middle of nowhere.
There's a lot of not mentioning things by name on this show, by the way, just so you know.
Yeah.
It was the most worst, too.
Yeah. Like you said, Tom. As I said, most worst. But we met there, and I had seen his zines before at other comic shows and stuff, and then I met him and I was like, wait, you're not as weird as I thought you would be judging by your comics. And
and then we found out we lived like right down the street from each other, right? Basically, like we lived in the same neighborhood, like 5 minutes away, so
we started hanging out,
fostered the
talking
relationship,
talking about comics and stuff.
Yeah, and I wonder, like, just for people out there, like, what a zine is, like a homemade magazine, basically.
Yeah.
DIY magazine.
Yeah. Homemade, booklet, comic, art zine, whatever.
Could be about music.
Yeah, it could be your diary, for Christ's sakes.
Could be anything. And I remember, you know, in the 90s, that was like a really big thing.
Yeah.
And what is like a zine fest in 2015 like? Or
there's a lot of them.
Yeah.
There's a lot more of it now, I think, than... Well, I mean, it was big in the 90s, and then I kind of think it faded for a while. But then... there's Zine Fest popping up all over. There's LA Zine Fest that's been happening for 4 years in a row now, I think, and SF Zine Fest, Chicago Zine Fest.
Yeah, there's tons.
Portland Zine Fest. They're all over the place now.
I mean, it's still similar. It's still the same sort of thing. It's homemade art by an individual artist made in a small edition. That's usually what, like, a zine is.
Yeah.
But now you just have all types of shit, you know?
There's a lot of a lot more comics and mini-comics being made that way now, too.
Well, it's interesting. It's almost like, to me, it seems like it kind of correlates with like the sort of like vinyl revolution, as far as like, you know, in the late 90s, like when the internet kind of started getting big for everybody, all these things like vinyl records and zines and all this stuff kind of went away. And then it seemed like, oh, well, all this stuff's not going to be around anymore because everyone's so into digital.
But then it all became like collector's niche kind of like specialized thing that...
Yeah, and now it's bigger than ever.
Yeah.
And now it's like people are making handmade actual, like Rolling Stone, and these things are going by the wayside, but like things like comic books and things, homemade DIY stuff and small limited edition vinyl records by bands are like bigger than ever. And the internet or whatever is almost like just a way to communicate that this stuff's out there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you guys find that like at like a zine fest or whatever, that's how it's kind of working these days? Or
basically, yeah. I mean, I feel like the internet's a tool that all these artists use in different ways, but the important thing is the actual work and like the books you create, the comics you make. So I think it's basically the same. I mean, It's basically the same as it's always been. You're making the art from an individual angle.
And I think there's still people that still want like a tangible object. You know, there's still an audience for that, even though like we're moving towards a world of non-tangible, everything's digital. There's still people that it seems want things like zines and vinyl, which is nice, but I honestly wonder how long that'll last, if that's more of like a specialized thing that's happening now, like, you know, like the tape, cassette tape explosion in like indie bands now. Is like there's no practical reason for that to be happening at all.
It's cute.
It's not easier to make. It's not cheaper. It's just a unique thing that everybody, that's become a trend, but it's completely stupid. Like there's no reason for it to happen.
Right.
But, you know, it's nice that people still want those things, you know, there is an audience for that, but, you know, how long will that last? I don't know.
But Tom, you've been doing this for a while now. Like, how did you get your start? Like, as far as, were you always doing comics as a kid or big into comics or?
Yeah, I mean, as long as I can remember from being really young, I was always drawing comics and either wanted to do comics or animation until like around high school, I think. I grew up in a small town in Texas, so like I only really had access to like, you know, Marvel and DC comics and Disney comics and stuff. So by the time I got to high school, I got more into art and fine art and stuff. So I went to art school and got sidetracked away from comics a bit. But I was always still drawing them in my sketchbooks and everything. At some point while I was in art school studying painting and getting completely fed up and disillusioned with the idea of the fine arts world, I kind of happened to stumble upon, like, I was in San Francisco and I found a lot of like self-published zines and alternative comics that I'd never seen before growing up, and that kind of opened me up to like, oh wait, doing comics doesn't just mean Spider-Man. There's a whole bunch of other stuff you can do. So at that point, I started getting into like the old stuff like Robert Crumb and S. Clay Wilson, and then newer guys like Dan Klaus and Chris Ware at the time were like big. But so I started making my own self-published comic at the same time I was doing finishing up my MFA in painting. And published my first book, self-published my first zine or mini comic when I graduated, and then immediately just started making comics from then. That was around 2000. I've been self-publishing since then. So,
I mean, I first heard of you, I think, in the same way that a lot of people did, which was the Henry and Glenn Forever. Which, I mean, do you want to talk about that for a minute and just let people know what that is?
Yeah. Well, that was an idea that kind of came through my. Excuse me, art fraternity.
We have allergies here in LA at this time of year. I have them as well. So,
but my art fraternity, the Igloo Tornado, which is me and three of my buddies, Jen Stevens, Scott Nobles, and Levon Jahanian, we just like to get together and talk about art, what we're working on. And we would occasionally put together like art shows together and everything. But one night when we were just like drinking beers and talk about art, Jen Stevens just said, like, there should be a book of, like, art that's like Tom of Finland, but it's with Henry Rollins and Glenn Danzig. And I just said, well, we're going to do that. Let's do it right now. And so we just, like, kind of started scribbling that stuff on bar napkins to, like, make each other laugh. And we made a zine of it. We were just, like, made, like, 100 Xerox copies that we took to a couple of Comic-Cons and sold out of them immediately, and everybody seemed to like it. And then it just kind of blew up from there to now. This last year, I just released a 240-page graphic novel that has over 60 different artists contributing, called Henry and Glenn Forever and Ever, which is the sequel to the original Henry and Glenn Forever. And, so it just keeps going.
And I think, I mean, I'm sure you've been asked this a ton of times or whatever, but, one thing that's really cool about the book is that you had Rob Halford do the forward.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which is just kind of
mind-blowing.
It's mind-blowing. It's also kind of perfect in a number of ways.
Oh yeah. It's perfect because he took the spirit of the book and he like turned it against me.
Yeah, he gets it. Yeah. You know, he finds it to be funny.
He did to me what I was doing to Henry and Glenn.
Right. And so that's kind of what I wanted to know is like, have you heard from them about it and what's their feeling? Or
from them personally, no. Indirectly, yes. When the original book, Henry and Glenn Forever, came out in 2009 or 10, we my friend Jay Bennett was interviewing Danzig for Decibel Magazine just when Death Red Sabbath came out, his last album. And so I gave him a signed gift-wrapped copy to give to Danzig. And so I guess he waited till the end of the interview to give it to him. So anyway, he was driving back home from Brentwood because Danzig lives in Lucille Ball's house. It's just weird.
Sure.
It's fitting.
And Jay was actually really upset. He's like, I was like, what happened? He's like, I'm really bummed out, man. It was a really great reaction. You're going to love it, but it made me really sad at the same time. And so then Jay got home and he sent me a transcript of Danzig's reaction to finding out about the book, and I made a comic strip of that, which is actually the last page of the new book, Henry England Forever and Ever. So you can actually read his direct quotes of him finding out about the book for the first time.
Wow. So we have to track that down then to find out what is
the reaction's perfect.
Yeah, it's
too.
In the book.
It's exactly what
he just well, he just throws a little fit. He's like, "What's wrong with this internet generation?" Like
he's notoriously known for his sense of humor.
Yeah.
And you know, good natured way of taking any rivings towards him, you know.
On the other hand, I think Henry Rollins wrote something in his LA Weekly column recently where he like said like he's I will never read this book, but I love that it exists.
I remember reading that. And which is exactly what he would say too. And
yeah.
And I mean, the thing about it is it's obvious, like, of course we're all huge Danzig fans,
yeah,
huge Misfits
them.
Fans.
Everybody
huge Black
involved
Flag
in the
fans.
Book loves them. You yeah. know, they all comes from a place of like love, you yeah. know, but you also have to be honest with who they are as people and icons as well. You know, and like they're funny, you know,
right.
as well. They're funny to make fun of and to love, you know, Henry Rollins' poetry is hilarious. You know,
anybody in the, you know, public figures. I mean, we really don't do much more than what Mad Magazine does to every other
exactly.
celebrity. It's just
exactly.
we just specifically totally. Targeted them and put them in a ridiculous scenario.
Do so. You think that you would ever like do something like that with another musician or artist, or do you think that that's like?
I don't think it works.
It doesn't work, right?
People throw that at me all the time. They're like, "Oh, what if like Ian MacKay and
Jello Biafra
yeah,
opened up a petting zoo?"
It's like that's already too complicated.
Right?
Like, you say Henry and Glenn forever, and everybody gets it.
Right. I mean, I think it's perfect to just have it be the one thing. I mean, you know, like you said, it is perfect just the way it is. And so, Keenan, I wanted to kind of ask you the sort of similar question and ideas about yourself, and I know you because I used to play in a band with your wife.
Yes.
And the Intelligence, and it's our friend Lars's band, and we were members of it. And that I guess that's how I must have met you.
Yeah, I think
first
I met
time.
You at Larry's house at a party one
yeah.
time, right when you first started playing with Leslie and the Intelligence.
Right, Larry from In the Red Records,
yeah.
who we put out the records with, and yeah, I met you there, and I think. When Leslie and I were driving together to San Francisco to play a show and listening to Metallica, and this is my voice is like this because I was doing Enter Sandman, or no, I was doing Master of Puppets karaoke last night. that and allergies together. But we were listening to all this early Metallica stuff, and she had a copy of all the Drippy Bone stuff.
Oh, like Galactic Breakdown?
Galactic Breakdown. And so I read all your comics on the way up because they were all in the car.
Yeah.
And she's like, I keep them in there, you know, in case someone wants to see my husband's work or
yeah.
whatever, you know. And I didn't know you at the time. But then I also was aware of your stuff because you'd done some artwork for that band, The Spits.
Yes.
And I just wanted to know, like, did you start out doing artwork for bands or were you doing comics originally too? And
no, I originally went to film school thinking I'd be like a filmmaker. I thought I'd write scripts and make movies. Then quickly when I moved to LA, realized I was never going to do that. I hated the industry. It was like the worst existence I could have imagined for myself. So I started looking towards other things I loved, and I love art. And then I really realized my first love had always been comics as a kid. But I kind of put them on the back burner because I can't draw.
Right. I mean, your style's pretty raw compared
yeah.
to Tom's.
Oh, there's a giant difference in a taste and skill level and lots of things. But yes, mine is, well, it's also because I didn't draw my first comic until like 2009. That Galactic Breakdown number one's the first comic I ever drew.
Right.
But before that, I'd started making zines and self-publishing and just doing, like, drawings and putting them together in books. That led to becoming a part of Driven Bone Books, and then that's what led to me started focusing on comics again. And that's Galactic Breakdown was the first comic I ever drew. So Roy's is the first character I ever came up with.
Which, before I met him at the most worst comic yes. show ever, I had found Galactic Breakdown number one at, I think, Secret Headquarters. And I remember, like, me and Johnny Ryan both looking at it together and being like, this is the dumbest, most amazing thing we've ever seen before. And I think Johnny Ryan, like, went home immediately and drew tribute art and sent
yeah.
it to you.
Yeah, he did a drawing of the first cover and put it on this blog covered.
Yeah.
That was kind of well-known in comics world, you know, because you just take an original cover and you'd redraw it in your own style. And he did that with that, and I still think more people have seen his version of the cover than mine, you know. Or the
and what
comic
is, what's
itself.
That called when you it's a specific thing?
Well, an homage. I don't
well,
know.
Yeah, I didn't. I was reading the Humans book, and at the
oh,
end
a
of
pin-up?
It, yeah, I guess so. At the end of the book, there's a bunch of different.
Oh yeah, pinups.
That's what they call
yeah,
them.
Yeah, well, there's like alternative covers sometimes, but for us, those are pinups. The artists just do a one-off drawing for us.
Yeah, I've noticed it in comics for years
yeah.
that it's like it's a accepted thing and pretty common. But is the idea then that you are
the idea when you were a kid you would cut it out of the magazine and pin it to your wall like a poster.
Right, so. Right.
But it's also like artists it's hard to collaborate as cartoonists
right.
as well. And like musicians can go jam, but cartoonists is like, oh, can I draw your character for
yeah,
you?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
then it's like, yeah, fuck yeah, I'll do yours, you know?
Yeah,
so it's one level of like collaboration that you know, because lots of cartoonists just wish they were rock stars, but they can't be, you know. They can't stand up and talk in front of people, you know, so.
And it's funny, you know, we're all fans of, like, each other's works, too,
yeah.
you know. So, like, like the artists that we had reached out to do pinups for the Humans are, like, people we love, like Benjamin Morrow and Katie Skelly and our colorist Christina Chiantas and Skinner. And, like, it's just awesome to get, like, artists you admire to, like, do your interpretations
yeah,
of your own thing. Like,
well, it's super cool to read the book and then at the end just see these like weird variations on the characters that you were just spent a bunch of time with.
Yeah.
You know, then all
yeah.
of a sudden there's like a like especially if it's like kind of this like serious, like kind of badass action adventure sort of situation, and then to have like a goofy version of that, like
yeah,
in
yeah.
the end, you know,
just
which
expands
I was
the universe a bit.
Totally, like I remember Marvel had some stuff like that too. Like they would have those like what if,
yeah,
or
yeah.
whatever, and it would be like
and
what if
the
what
too.
Yeah, what if this happened? And I remember there, I used to have a comic where it was like this. It was all the characters of Spider-Man and whoever, you know, but they were all like kids, you know,
oh.
and just like I remember thinking like that sort of stuff just kind of. Blew my mind when I was
alternate universe stuff where they can take these characters you think you know and then they do something
because I was never that huge into like the straight up comics, but when I would see stuff like that where it would just be like a baby Spider-Man and the problems that he was having with like
yeah.
the baby Hulk
or Spider-Ham
yeah Spider-Ham
yeah Spider-Ham
well it's like
yeah.
that, a lot of underground cartoonists and comics now too is are taking that and running with it, you know, like lots of people like will do their what's that Calgary Wolverine comic that came out a couple
yeah.
years ago where he's like killing Mounties
but he's Canadian already isn't he
yeah
okay
yeah but people take these characters and do their own underground stuff with it.
I did it with Popeye.
Yeah, he's done it with Popeye.
I've
done it. I put Driven Bone Books put out a Marvel Comics Presents issue,
right?
That we could have been sued for and like cease and desist, you know. But we each took like D grade characters from the Marvel universe and just riffed on them.
But what were the books that you guys were reading when you were kids? Like, what were the ones that you were really into?
I was like a Marvel boy. Like DC looked good, but I never really read them. So I was into X-Men, Wolverine, Punisher, and then I started getting into a little bit weirder stuff like Trencher. And, like, some of the early Image stuff I like to look at. But it wasn't until I found out about underground comics when I was much older, like 60s and 70s underground, that
yeah.
that's when I started seeing comics that I was, like, blown away by.
Yeah, similar for me. I mean, I started with, like, Disney and Archie much younger, but then pretty much graduated Marvel in DC, but mostly into Marvel. And then once I got to college, I got way into just everything underground, anything I could find, like, I remember, like, in the 90s, it was a great time for quarter bin shopping to find, like, all the, like, 80s glut, like, weird independent stuff that you'd never heard of before
yeah.
in, like, quarter bins at every comic shop. And so, like, that's what I'd go and find, anything that I'd never heard of. So I discover, like, that's where I've found, like, Tim Vigil work and, like, early Escalade Wilson stuff. And, like, it's where I discovered Crumb and Rene French and all those guys. So,
yeah, can you talk a little bit about Escalade Wilson? Because I know in the Humans book, there's, like, you guys did, like, kind of a tribute page to him, which is, like, I know the name and I know some of his work. I didn't understand what the tribute was, but it was, like, it's kind of this biker scene outside of a bar.
Yeah, basically, I took, like, he did a series of a lot of comics and also, like, just, like, paintings and drawings of just biker scenes that were a lot of his friends and biker gangs that he hung out with.
And he did lots of, like, one-panel explosions.
Yeah, like crowd just giant scenes crowd scenes. And so I took one of those and it basically just took the composition of his and, like, fit our characters into it. So it was, like, a loose tribute of, like, but it was important to me and to us, I think, because he's an influence on both of us artistically. And he was an actual cartoonist who, you know, lived among the bikers and kind of, like, was invested in that culture. So
and he was, like, invested in his own, like, persona, too. Yeah, you know, yeah, he was, yeah, like, just his comics were they're unforgiving. You know, like, they're just nasty. Awesome. Whatever he could think of, he'd draw. He had no internal censor.
No filters.
Yeah, whatsoever. And so he made some of the best comics.
Right. I remember, and I guess we should talk about the Humans because we're sort of getting there slowly and surely. We keep bringing it up. And can we explain what that is so that people get the context of what the Humans is? And I mean, that's kind of how we got here anyways, was when you guys came up with the idea for the Humans. You guys are now opening a bag for some reason,
and that's pulling out the book.
Well, you're pulling out the book that no one can see.
No, but he can read copy off of it.
I see. So the
kind of time to rehearse your pitch, Keenan.
Oh yeah. This isn't a commercial for the Humans, but we sort of got to this place because you guys had come to me and my band to do a song, because in the original issue, the zero, volume zero of it or whatever, issue zero, you guys wanted to have a 7-inch that came along with it as, like,
yeah, soundtrack,
a soundtrack to the comic. So that's kind of how we got together on this in the beginning. And now you guys are how many issues deep on it?
Well, the first collection just came out in March, The Humans, Volume 1, Humans for Life, and it collects issues 0 through 4, so that's the first 5 issues. And then issue 5 starts up next month in June, or I'm not sure when this airs, but we've got 6 more issues to go. We'll go through issue 10 with the second volume.
And what is The Humans then?
It's a comic about a biker gang of ape men in 1970s Bakersfield, California. It's a, as it says on the back of the book, a high-octane, no-holds-barred aper biker gang chopper ride into 1970s exploitation genre bliss.
So, yeah, when you guys came to me with, like, your guys were, like, sort of, like, we're doing Planet of the Apes meets, like, you know,
Easy Rider,
or whatever. Yeah. That's the easy way to say it, or like Wild Angels or something.
Yeah,
more.
Right.
Because Easy Rider is not. It's not a gang.
Wild Angels, yeah.
No, no.
But I was like, yeah, fuck yeah, that's like totally. I can write lyrics to that for sure. You know, like that's like so up my alley.
You don't need to know very much more than that.
That's all
you'd
I needed to know.
You'd already written like enough songs. I mean, you did one about a famous great horror biker movie.
Well, you guys actually have a tribute page in there.
Tom drew that one.
Psychomania.
Yeah.
For Psychomania, which that film also has another name I can't remember. But
The Living Dead or something.
Something like that, yeah. Living Dead, yeah. It's like a British film.
Yeah.
But I had written a song called Psychomania about that film because, if anyone hasn't seen it, it's these bikers.
Go watch it.
They have to kill themselves so that they can
they become undead.
And there's frogs
and there's like mystical frogs.
Yeah. It's always foggy.
It's insane. You know. And all the suicides are the most ridiculous suicides ever.
Yeah.
I think it's on Netflix too. Like go watch it. It's a fucking great movie.
Yeah, I don't want to spoil it, but there's a guy that drives a motorcycle out of a grave.
Yeah.
You spoiled it.
No, I was gonna spoil it.
I don't want to spoil it, but
I'm not gonna spoil it, but yeah. There's a frog amulet.
There's a lot of frogs.
So yeah, when I saw that in the book, I was like, "Holy shit!" Like these guys really fucking get it.
Because I don't know how many people actually get that. Because like early on when we had that, is a variant cover that we released for
for the UK.
There was a British comic company that wanted us to do a variant cover, which, if you don't know, variant cover is just the same as issue number one, but with a different cover. So it's more limited edition. So I was like, well, it's a British company. I'll do my favorite British biker movie tribute. So I did the Psychomania thing. And then so many of our fans at our initial Comic Cons were like, does that mean that, like, Mojo's coming back to life? Like, he's going to come back? Because Mojo is, like, a character that dies at the beginning.
In the first issue.
Right, so they were really reading.
But they didn't, like, get it. So people were like, what's with the frogs?
People don't get it.
But that's fine. That's fun.
Sure.
I get to say, like, go watch this movie. Yeah. Because that's what, I don't know, that's part of what we like about this.
We
is, like,
get it. That's,
we're steeped in that exploitation cinema, and we're exploring that fun world, and we hope that that'll, you know, bring that to other people.
I mean, I totally get it, and I think I feel the same way in the sense of, like, I have a really hard time writing songs about, like, love and girls and stuff.
Really?
But, yeah, but if I see a movie where there's dudes that are killing themselves so they come back to life,
gotta write a song
and there's
going
to be a frog involved, which I love frogs already, so that it just makes it perfect. So I totally understand, and then that just falls more in line with what you guys are into.
Yeah, and it's about, like, a tone that we're trying to present too. Right. So, like, that still fits in our world, even though it has nothing to do with it. But it's the tone is what we're going for.
Yep.
And you mentioned, so in the 90s, like, when did, so you guys are working with Image on this.
Yeah, we
which
got
is
picked
cool.
up by Image. We self-published to issue zero and then got picked up by Image to do the series.
I mean, Image came out, like, in the 90s, right? Like,
yeah.
I remember I lived in a really small town in eastern Washington.
In 92, was it?
Yeah. I don't know. I remember I lived by this guy. His name was Chance Wolf, and he was...
that's his real name.
Chance
Sounds
Wolf.
Sounds like a Rob Liefeld character.
Yeah, I know, right?
Well, the Wolf family, like, we were in this really small town, and one of the guys was in, like, a rock band. The other guy was, like, he was an amazing artist, but he did, like, that's those 80s, like, kind of, like, chick, like, it's like a woman, like
Nagel
yeah. style art. Yeah. He did, like, his own version of Nagel. And then the other guy, he had MS and he was in a wheelchair, but he did comics, inking, I think.
Wow.
Or coloring. What do you call it? Inking?
Inking's when you apply the ink over the pencils.
I think that's what he did for Image. And they had a comic called Nighthawk.
Oh, yeah.
Which was one of the early ones. And I remember going to the 7-Eleven in my small town, and they had a comic rack, you know, back then, and buying that comic, but also knowing that this guy lived in my town.
And did it.
And did it, which was super weird to me at the time. But did you guys, like, were you guys, like, into Image comics when...
I mean...
I didn't buy a lot of them when I was a kid. I was into, like, the covers, and I really liked Liefeld on New Mutants. Like, when I was a kid, I really loved that he did the end of that series for Marvel, and then he was like, fuck this, I'm going to jump ship. And I also liked Todd McFarlane on Spider-Man a lot, too, even though I didn't really like Spider-Man, but his drawings of, like, hair and web were just so much more interesting, and everything was much more dynamic. So when they were doing other comics, I'd always be interested in them. But I never... It's also, you know... 6 months, eight to a year in with Image, like, they couldn't get comics out fast enough, you know, like, the titles, like, they had some problems with getting shit out on time. So
for me, it was around the time that I was, like, kind of losing interest in comics as a career and getting more into, like, going into art school and stuff, but I was still reading them, and I was really interested in, like, watching these guys shift from being, like, if you don't know the history, it was basically six or seven of the top artists at Marvel who are being, like, paid tons, more money than anybody had ever been paid for comics ever before. They were, like, the first, like, rock star cartoonists of the early 90s working on Spider-Man and everything and X-Men, and then they all jumped ship and formed their own company because they wanted to own the rights to all the stuff that they were drawing and creating. And so I was, like, really fascinated by watching that transition and, like, liked the idea of that, but I didn't really follow many of the comics that much, but I was very... interested in that thing. Savage Dragon was, like, the one that I always read. Eric Larson's Savage Dragon. I've got every issue of that for some reason. But everybody else, I was kind of, like, hit or miss with what they were doing.
That's a cool name.
But
it's good.
Yeah.
I didn't, you know, when I was, like, you know, still a kid when that happened with Image. So I didn't really understand, like that these were artists leaving. You know, I didn't understand. And now that we're working with them and we understand what they did, it's pretty amazing and awe-inspiring because it's like Image is an artist-friendly company.
Yeah, it's like we can definitely tell that it's like it's this company was created for and by artists and for them to like own their stuff and like get the credit they deserve for what they do, and it's really great.
So how did the deal with them come about? Did they approach you guys, or did you?
Sort of a friend of mine who works at the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund was aware of what we were doing, and we were planning a Kickstarter to self-publish the series at the time. And I guess my friend had said he had mentioned it to Eric, the publisher at Image, and that he was interested, and we should send it to him. And so we did, and yeah, then it was just kind of like, he was like, yeah, let's do it.
Sure.
Yeah, it was the easiest meeting ever I'll ever have in my life, too.
Totally. And so then now what do you guys do with it to like promote it? So the first five issues, 0 through 4 are out, then Image compiles them into a book. Is that like a common thing to do as well?
Yeah, the comic industry has really become more about mostly about graphic novels and volumes more than single issues. So most comics now, most regular series are collected like every 6 to 12 issues. They'll put out a graphic novel collecting the larger story because that then goes into the book market beyond comic shops and
some people aren't
a much larger reading audience. So
some people aren't interested in buying like a $3 comic once a month for like 6 months. They might, they just want to wait
and get
just
the whole story,
get those six in one. So,
it's like
Image does it all the time.
It's like if you released an album, a single at a time, and then you released the album, you know, some people would wait for the album. Some people would buy the singles. Single.
Sure. I think Jay Riotard did that. It's not as much as common in music, but it is a cool thing, and I've seen people do it before, or they'll just compile a bunch of singles into an album later down the road.
The difference between now and like when we were growing up buying comics, though, is like back then, like a graphic novel was like kind of a rare thing, like a special event book, like Secret Wars would get collected, but like not everything. Now
I remember
everything gets collected
right as
a book eventually, so.
I just remember graphic novels being like at the bookstore, like in the mall, and just being kind of like fascinated by.
And they'd be expensive, you know.
And they'd like be like cussing,
bucks, you know.
And
then saving up for that Dark
Knight.
That's
when they could do a little more adult.
Yeah, you would see like a boob or whatever, and it would be like, "Whoa, there's a boob in Spider-Man or whatever." Like, and it's totally like printed on like nice paper. I didn't understand it at all at the time. It was just like totally weird to me. But you guys have like a lot of boobs. Well, you know, you guys have a lot of penises. There's more penises.
Well, yeah, we pride ourselves on
you guys.
More
Tom
penises
draws a great penis.
Yeah,
I swear
he draws a mean penis.
I'm known for that. Yeah.
And
I draw mean boobs too, but nobody ever talks about
your penises are far better than your boobs. I like the boobs are great, but the cock is just like amazing on all like. And in the humans world, the actual Homo sapiens or people are slaves.
Well, they're more like cattle. Sometimes they're like slaves. Sometimes they're circus animals. Sometimes they're experimental animals. Like the same way we treat apes in the real world.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. And they're always naked.
Yes.
Yeah. Same way we
Why
treat
would we
apes in the real world.
Animals, you know, they don't do anything. It doesn't do anything for me.
Except we might dress them up like a clown for laughs, like if you dress up a human in ape clothing.
Well, in the series, they also use them to like fight. You know,
they do like human cock fighting or dog fighting. It's like
so they raise them. You try to make them stronger. You know, there's like a training involved in that as well, probably. You know, but most of the time they're just dumb, lame, grunt work animals.
Yeah. That's horrifying.
Yeah, well.
Well, but, it's horrifying if you can't envision yourself as an ape.
Think of a cow's day. It's petrified.
Oh, it's a nightmare, Well, I think that's what's kind of interesting about it is you take what we, you know, normally feel for granted and you flip it upside down and then you're like, oh, it is awful, like, what we do to monkeys.
It's funny to me to see, like, how, like, horrific that is to some of our fans, too.
Some people are really upset about it.
I didn't think about it until I read it, and I was just like, this is horrifying, like.
To me, I've been a vegetarian vegan for, like, 20 years now, so it's like, to me, it just, like, makes sense. Like, why wouldn't you, like, experimental drug experiments on your human slave. But like then everybody's like, oh my God, that's horrifying. I'm like,
and I eat meat and I know sense. I'm a murderer.
I've seen you do that, you know, to monkeys. Like, so
right. And so what's next for the humans then? You guys are you got the next issue coming out is number 5 or?
Yeah, yep. Number 5 in June.
Yep, and then it'll be issues 5 through 10 is kind of finish off the first major storyline that we're working on. So that'll all come out by the end of this year.
And do you go to like, say, you go to Comic-Con, and what's the point of like going to a Comic-Con or something like that for you guys? Like, is promotion or just...
I ask myself that every yeah. time.
Well, there's multiple
I wonder
things.
About it in the sense of like, what is South by Southwest for bands? What
well,
is Sundance for
different
filmmakers?
Than that.
It's yeah.
Just, well, actually, I don't know. It depends on where you're going. Like, if you're going to like a smaller convention, like the smaller alternative press conventions that we go to, it's more like, you know, you're standing there selling your stuff and meeting fans and stuff. But like Comic-Con, like San Diego Comic-Con, it is more like South by Southwest. Like 15, 20 years ago, it was a small place where you'd go and sell your stuff.
It's
now,
like bigger.
It's like it? The biggest thing in the world, and you go there basically to network and make deals and find jobs.
Yeah.
And like, be seen and like you do some signings and stuff, but it's like a totally too. Different beast. It's not, you know, and it's taken over by the Hollywood industry now. So comics are very peripheral to it.
It depends what you're doing at them too. You know, yeah. like if you're going to do one of these monstrous ones like Comic-Con, you don't want to be like running a table or anything like that because it's impossible to
well,
get
just
one.
Cost him. I did it.
It costs too much. It's impossible to get one. You know, all that. It's much better to go and like. Tactical strike, like get in, do a signing at a booth, get out, you well, know, then get to hang out with all these cartoonists and people you don't get to see yeah. from all over the world, you know. To me, most of the time, the cons, I want to go to them for a social element as much as anything because I don't get to see all these guys very often, you
yeah.
know.
Comic-Con used to be doable as like a tabling thing. I did it for 10 years, but then it just like got so expensive to have a table there that... I gave up, and then it became like just a fun networking kind of like, let's go.
Yeah, it's fun to be there and then leave before it gets crazy on like
it sounds
Saturday.
Like South by Southwest. It's yeah, like you want to go in and play like one or two shows and then get the fuck out of there
yeah.
as
yeah.
soon as possible.
Yeah, like last year we went in for like 2 days, did a signing or two at Image, and then
went to a
couple
parties
at
night
and got out of there.
Yeah,
and it was fun.
We left on Saturday before when it gets like so
whereas
disgusting where it smells like crotch.
Like
and
5 years ago,
everywhere.
I'd be there for 6 days behind a table as my mind yeah. just slowly turns into oatmeal.
That
as
shit
you
watch will kill
people
you.
Walk
you know?
By all day. It drives you nuts. It's insane. It's one of the most psychedelic experiences you can have.
And it's
standing
one of the,
behind a table for 6 days at that thing.
It's one of the best things we could have. Learned by doing self-publishing too is like now we know like some of these events it's just good to get there and do like a couple things and get out and other ones we should table, you know, like
we're doing one in North Carolina next month called Heroes Con, so that should be interesting. It's our first time to go there, but it's more of a smaller like we'll be at a table selling stuff and selling
yeah are there stuff. Ones that are cool that you really like and like
oh yeah yeah there's some that are just a blast
yeah, yeah.
It's there's like a you know cartoonist camp. You know, everybody
yeah,
stays in the same
the
hotel.
Place.
Everybody just gets hammered and hangs out all night and then wakes up really early and goes to their table hungover, you know, and then you do it again, you know.
That's great. Well, what's the next thing for, is there going to be like a humans cartoon or is there, is
it, we'll see. I don't know. We'll see. We're just kind of concentrating on getting the comics done. We'd be open to that. We'll see what
yeah.
happens. It'd be
I
cool.
I mean, anything that,
but,
that would be something that we would love to do.
Yeah.
But, Right now, Tom's so ass deep in drawing comics that he's just got to look at one thing at a time. But
well, we should be clear about that. So, Keenan, you basically write the story.
Yeah, I write a script, and then he draws
it. And then he draws it.
And then
Christina Cayontas colors it.
So you have it really easy
yeah, basically.
Compared to Tom.
Compared
well,
to
he's
Tom,
done
yeah.
for the most part.
Because you just watched Planet of the Apes and a bunch of biker movies and then just
and I just
take
write some
stuff
shit.
Out
yeah.
you
yeah.
steal everything from that and then Tom has
long,
to actually
but yeah then Tom's gotta draw it and he's gotta
draw it all.
He's gotta decipher my dyslexic scripts too you
yeah
know,
there's
and like,
a lot of editing involved
yeah there's editing so
yeah we're I mean we're, but because we're figuring it out as we go this is the first time we've done like a monthly series so like
yeah
you know, we're not really
and
accustomed.
Or it's
and
the first
got
time
kind of like
I've ever written for somebody and he's ever drawn.
Yes,
somebody, somebody
so
else
we're
written,
figuring
so.
Out our rhythm, but it's been funny because like when we got to issue 4 and he got me the script, and I was like,
yeah, it was huge. It was way too big.
Holy shit, this is like 3 issues worth of script. Like, so I had to like squat and we didn't
yeah.
have time to like change that. So I had to squash it down and edit it down to like, I think it works
yeah,
fine.
We
but,
talked, we just talked but, about like, okay, let's cut so this and let's truncate this and then boom.
I'm like,
got it
I'm
in
not
there.
Just the penciling inker. I'm also like the director and the editor and the everything else, except Christina's coloring it, and she does the final art that makes it really great. But
well, I think it's awesome, and I think like if you're into like, you know, biker movies or exploitation or music or film or art or anything like that, then you're probably gonna totally dig this fucking comic book.
Yeah,
because it's pretty raw stuff, which is what's awesome about it. Because there's not a lot of that kind of shit out there. Right?
Yeah. No,
like,
I mean,
we're trying to make it as raw and fun as possible.
We want to make like as close to something that could be an underground comic today, but have it be put out through like a large chain of distribution. You know,
sure.
Image is allowing us to.
We're not even really trying to do that. That's
it's just what it is.
Like, I mean, I don't know how to do like a polished, like fancy modern comic. Like this is like what we do.
Yeah, and Image, you know, the best thing about them is that they've had no say in the content of the book. They've not one note, not anything. They're not like, can you dial back the a penis or anything? None of that.
So right.
We get to do what we want to do.
And where can people find it then? Like,
it should be in comic shops and bookstores everywhere now. It's also on Amazon. Like the first volume collection is only $10. It might be even cheaper on Amazon right now.
Yeah, I think it's like $9.30.
And then each issue, starting with 5, starts coming out monthly in June. Those will be in comic shops first Wednesday of every month. For the rest of the year.
If you want it, just go ask your comic book shop, dude, or look it up online. It's on Amazon.
Well, I think it's great what you guys are doing, and I'm super stoked for you guys. And I think when I first heard about it, I thought like, oh, that sounds pretty cool. And then to see like how many people are actually super stoked on it.
Should mention the soundtrack has continued too beyond the initial 7-inch.
Who do we have coming up on it?
We've had 8 songs released, including Coliseum, songs by Coliseum and Wizard Rifle and. Goblin Cock, Fairlight Empress,
Smelly Tongues,
Boss Kong, and Smelly Tongues.
And then the next issue, with issue 5, we have Gary Wrong Group.
Oh, awesome.
Speed Buggy, and Degreaser.
Yep. And then upcoming, we have stuff from other bands like Saviors, Witches of God, and who are some of the other? You had some. Funny thing is we both have like our own set of bands that we've been talking to. And like mine are all metal bands.
We will be having another 7-inch put out that won't be collected any other time.
Oh,
it'll be a one-off. That's going to be the Cunts and Bits of Shit on In the Red.
Oh, cool.
So that should be coming out. That should be
that's
in those songs.
That's two different bands. Cunts.
And Bits of Shit.
Not Cunts and the Bits of Shit.
No, that's two bands.
Because sometimes we play on this show like this like game where I give you a band name and you have to tell me whether it's real or not. And Cunts and the Bits of Shit could have been on there.
When we tell people about our soundtrack, bits everybody's like, are these really real band names? Every time we're like, are these real band names?
Yeah, all the cartoons. Goblin like the comic Cock. Reviewers. Yeah.
Yeah, Cunts. Yeah. If you don't know the stuff, it does sound it like you're just
absurd.
Making it up.
It sounds absurd, but it's exciting. I'm excited because I love the Cunts and Bits of Shit kind of like got back together to record a song for it. So
yeah,
it's like awesome our Ozploitation 7-inch coming out like at the end of the year.
That's killer. That's great. Well, fuck. Well, I'll look for it then.
Yeah, well, the LP will be awesome.
Is there anything you guys want to keep promoting?
Yeah,
can we end the show?
Sorry.
No, thank you so much for coming in. It's great. Yeah, I love the fucking book and I know what you guys are doing. I appreciate you guys being on the show. Alright, what you're hearing right now is the Humans March Let's Die Zigzags track that came with the first issue of the Humans comic book. If you want to learn more about Humans, go to their website, humansforlife.com. If you want to hear more Zigzags music, go to zigzags.bandcamp.com. This song and others are up there. You can listen to them for free. You can download them. You can do whatever you want with them. Check it out. I'll see you next time. Jed Mayhew, Jedbanger's Ball. As always, we're here at the Green Street Studios, sponsored by This Is Not a Pipe, in beautiful Los Angeles, California.